Okay, welcome back to our second topic of the day, and this is also a very interesting topic, bundling JavaScript library with npm webpack, which npm and webpack, which we day to day work on our JavaScript applications, right? So which will be talking by Varun De. He is an engineer of Grofers. So over to you, Varun. You can introduce yourself and then jump into the talk.
Thank you, Petro. Hey, so I'm Varun. Let me quickly share my screen. Let me know when you can see it. Okay, guessing it is visible.
Yeah, I think people, you can do a thumbs up, guys. Yeah, I see some thumbs up. I can see your screen, Varun.
All right. Hey, hello everyone. Afternoon. Thank you for coming online on a Saturday afternoon on this wonderful Bangalore weather. I'm Varun, and I'm a software engineer at Grofers, and I'll be talking about building a JavaScript package with Webpack and npm.
Hey, Varun, sorry to interrupt you.
Sure.
Sorry. So Janardhan is our so Janardhan, who is the founder of JavaScript Meetup, so he wants to just take 2 minutes for some talk.
Sure.
So we'll just start there. Sorry about it. Hey, Janardhan, I'm just pulling you in. Hey Janardhan, can you come on stage? I'm pulling you in. Hey, it looks like some issue with Janardhan. Hey, okay. Janardhan, you in?
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, so you can go ahead. So Janardhan is our the founder of this JavaScript Meetup. So he will just talk about 2 minutes of our new Discord channel TWAP, which we are doing, and we are doing a coffee chat also every Saturday. So Janardhan, over to you.
Sure. Hey folks, sorry Varun, sorry to interrupt in between. I thought I'll just take a moment and then brief people about what we call it. We have a Discord channel. Hello everyone. Good afternoon. We have a Discord channel. If you are familiar with Slack or Teams, it's almost same. We found Discord to be very good in terms of interaction, having separate channels for each of agenda, every topic of your interest. Let me share my screen and show you just a 2 minute overview of what we can do on Discord. That might help you understand better. If you're already on Discord, we have channels in terms of the learning paths. We have different learning paths that people can go for, whether you are on front-end development, back-end development, machine learning, blockchain, any of those you can do. And we have exclusive one for software testing, gaming development, and others. If you're interested, you go there. Joining is very simple. In addition, it also has multiple features. It has features like voice channels. If you are not able to sort out your things in a text chat over a period of time, you can just quickly go to... Yeah, I'm sharing my entire screen.
It's not visible, Janardhan. No.
Yeah, either. It'll be coming now. Yeah,
it's coming. Yeah, we can see Janardhan.
Yeah, this is our Discord group. We call it as Techies with a Purpose. We have created, this is an offshoot and initiative from JavaScript Meetup. After so many years of running JavaScript Meetup, we realized that we need such a channel where interaction can be two-way communication and also peer-to-peer communication is encouraged. You can, as soon as you join, you come to this general and you can visit our welcome page. We talk about three things that you can do. You can introduce yourself, join the channels. We have a lot of channels and you can start contributing. It's just a three-step simple process. In addition, we have around 542 people. Our goal is reaching 1,000. That way the interactions is more engaging and, you know, we can have better communication. If you're looking for job opportunities, we have an exclusive channel for jobs. We have it under the group called Career. You can see job postings happening. Quite a lot of people do post their jobs and also people who got benefited from it. We have an exclusive channel for graduates. If you want to join the channel, graduate looking for advice or coaching, mentoring, we have a separate channel. So these are the good stuff, a lot of good stuff happening. These are the voice channels. If you want to have practice some sessions before giving a talk or speech, you can always do this. Okay. Yeah, with that overview, thank you all. I think over to Varun. Thanks, Patro.
Yeah, thank you, Janardhan, for this. So guys, I think we have posted our Discord channel link on the chat, so you can join that and you can join our coffee chat session. That was a casual discussion. Any queries you have apart from tech queries, also related to career, learning opportunities, contributing to the open source, anything, you can connect over to us on coffee chat. We or our experts will definitely try to help you. Okay, thank you, Janardhan. So, hey, Varun, over to you. Sorry to interrupt you in between. Over to you. Stay.
No worries. Thank you. Right. Hope this is visible again. Okay. Yeah. So.
Yeah, your PPT is visible. Video is off.
Well. Fine. How about now? All right.
Yeah.
Right. Hey all, I'm Varun. I'm a software engineer at Gophers. And today I'll be talking about building a JavaScript library, your own JavaScript library with Webpack and NPM. And I'm pretty sure you might be somewhat familiar with this, the basic primer of what you're expecting out of this talk. So in current JavaScript ecosystem, it's pretty hard to build your own any app. Without using any external library, be it React, be it like even for a network call, you might be using Axios or something else. And for like weird string manipulation, you might be using Lodash or something like this. For testing, you would be using Jest, testing library, or anything like, right, XYZ, anything. So we'll be talking about building, how you can build, what goes on behind the scenes of building a library as such, and how you can build your own. So with that, let's just like kind of quick do a quick walkthrough of what you can expect out of this talk. Oops. Is this still visible? Oops. All right. Sorry, my electricity just fluctuated. Right. Okay. So we'll be talking about building. So since this is not very specific in the title description, I'll be talking about building a front-end specific JavaScript library, since you can also build a library in Node for your Node specific purpose if you're running a server, something in your server. But it shouldn't be very much different. I'll be putting out the pointers where it might just differ, which are very few. But otherwise, other than that, we will be talking mostly about building it for the front end purpose, that is for your serving it on the browser, right? And of course, NPM is just one of the package manager in JavaScript. There is Yarn, and I'm pretty sure there might be multiple other than this as well. And similarly, there are multiple builders, there are multiple bundlers for JavaScript. There's Webpack, there's Browserify, there's Rollup, which abstract most of the things, and many, many more, right? So again, this is very specific to Webpack and NPM, right? There are, although there are like many lectures around this thing, we'll be talking about how you can like specifically build your library for your own use case. So this should cover at least your building the library for your multiple use cases, not only say for one, right? We'll be talking about it on a very generic point of view, from a very generic point of view, right? And of course, we'll be talking about how to test your library and how to like split up the test between your client versus the library. And the most important thing that we'll be talking about is for the deployment. So most of the things, the point one, two, one and two, and probably three as well, you can find many lectures around it. But what I have noticed from my own experience is that you can also deploy it for public use. You can use NPM registries, you can use GitHub package registry now, but there are not enough ways in which you can deploy it, say to your organization, within your organization or within a group, right? And we'll be talking about that, how to deploy it for private use, also public use, and also how to consume it, right? With that done, a bit about me. So I'm a software engineer at Gophers. I have been in industry for around 3 years, a bit more than 3 years. Although my main working profession, I have fiddled around with JavaScript, but I would not consider myself as a front-end engineer. I like to work across the stack. I have my production deployed on Python, Django, this GraphQL, Postgres, a bit of Java and stuff like that. So I focus more on building solutions and not only for specific to front end. If you say what I mean by that is, if you say, ask me about what is the difference between use memo and use callback in React, I might not exactly know that. But if you ask me how for each works in JavaScript, I can like explain you how iteration protocol works under the hood in JavaScript, right? Okay, so I occasionally write at varunday.me. That's my personal portfolio. You can chat with me on sdcode. That's my Twitter handle. And I love reading books. I love reading fiction. This is my read list. If you are interested, goodreads.com/varunday. And personally, I also love football. I adore football and 90s rock. RHCP is my personal favorite. All right. So the why, let's talk about the why of building a JavaScript package. Why in the first place would you even want to build a JavaScript package, right? There could be multiple use cases for it, right? Say you have a very well-defined front-end architecture which is serving all your needs as such, but say you have a business requirement which you want to show a map, right, on your front-end. You have two pointers which are selected from your client, and you want to show a map, you want to show the direction, you want to show a direction, you want to show a distance between them. If you take a public transport route, it will take this time. If you take your own vehicle, it will take this time. Something sort of Google Maps, but say you are building an in-house tool, right? And you won't just shove it up in your front-end architecture. You would want to have a separate library for it, and you would want to use this library in your front-end architecture, and probably just like expose some of the APIs with the parameters, and it will give you the result, right? Which will you just render in your front-end. Other example could be, let's say you're building a machine learning model for your front end, right? And you, again, would not want to put this up in your front end build. You would want to have it a separate modular design of its own and use that. So that could be one of the use cases. Other use cases, you're building your own UI design system, right? You notice that your developers for your front end system, for your client front end system, they are redefining, say, a button component with the styles all over the place, right? There is this button in your home.jsx, there is one in your about section, about.jsx. And like, it's literally boilerplate happening all over again, right? You would want to abstract that out as a separate library, and you would want to build a design system for that, which has all the stylings inbuilt, and probably your you would want to expose as a, again as an API, but as a, that API is a component now, and you would want to pass the whatever parameters as a props to the component, right? So that is one. Other one could be for your building, you're building an SDK for to support your front end architecture. You already have one well defined, but so you want to like plug in an auth system, right? Or say a logging system to your this thing. You would want to have a separate SDK, and then you would want to use that in your front end. Just do an import of that, and then do all sort of things from the APIs, right? So these are some of the use cases. It could very well differ for each and everyone of the whatever problem that you are trying to solve, right? Let's look at a very simple example, right? What exactly do I mean, or how do we notice a pattern when you are trying to modelize something, right? So say you have a file, right? You have a calculator.js, which has few functions. You have add, subtract, multiply, divide, does something. And then you have at the bottom of it, you have something like result, which is taking add something and the subtract, multiply, whatever. By the way, I know like all these parameters can take multiple parameters. So just like this is for the brevity sake, please don't review my code. So you have a result defined underneath it, which is taking all these functions and doing something. But now you have a use case saying, oh, hey, I have some other file, foobar.js, and it also requires all these functions, right? So naive way to handle that, to solve for that, would be just like, you know, to copy all these functions in the foobar.js and have it called over there as well, right? So you have here it, you have it here, but that's not exactly what you want. Being a good developer that we are, we will export it as an API, right? Say you have a util function, which is calculator.js, right? And you have all this now definition signature defined in over there, right? You have all the things, and now in your file, whichever you want to use, you can just import that from the calculator or whichever file that you use, and then you can use it, right? So it is like available across your project. This import statement is if you're using any bundler, like Webpack or anything, this will be taken care of, and this will be available in your app during your runtime, right? So like you do not have to care about how it is doing it, right? You just export it somewhere, have the method signature somewhere, and you import it. But if the same problem, if you want to modularize it, right? If you want this calculator.js, right, to be available across your different projects, you have it in your project, say A, you want the same thing, you want the same calculator.js to also be available in your project B, right? Again, what we just discussed, we can have the same thing over in project B as well, or we can just modularize this for a library, right? What I mean by that is now we will be building a calculator.js, but with a package, right? So that you can use it across for different projects, right? You can build it, then you can deploy it, and then any of our clients can use it, right? So here's the point where the slides get a bit thick in knowledge because of the content each of it holds. So please feel free to ask questions at this point in time, right? So for this, for modernizing a library, we'll be using again two things that as we discussed. One is obviously NPM and Webpack. How NPM interacts with your app is using a file called package.json, which you might be familiar with. And similarly for Webpack, you have a webpack.config.js. Webpack is a bundler which basically interacts with your entire app through a binary, right? So you run Webpack some command and it does what is asked of it, right? So this is how my package.json, npm package.json looks like, right? So you can see I have my name defined in of the package. I have the version, I have files and main, right? So what this means is I'm gonna bundle this app, right? And the bundler is going to generate a dist folder, which is going to be my distributable, which I'm going to distribute to my clients, right? Now what I want out of npm is, hey, the distributable of this entire app, I want that to be dist, right? And the entry point of this distributable is going to be index.js, which is in the main, which is in the dist, right? So this is the entry point of this thing, right? I can explain it a bit better. So you have an app, right? You have a calculator.js. You have inside your source is all your source code. You have a test folder as well. Then you have multiple config file. You would have Babel.rc. You would have webpack config, jest config, etc., etc. And now when you are bundling it using a webpack, so for this thing you would run npm run build. So the webpack executable gets called. Webpack would have its own configuration file, so it will get called and it'll do its thing. Then what I want out of this is, once the build is done, I want all the distributable to be from the dist folder, right? And the index.js is the main entry point out of it, right? We have not defined it how. So Webpack, we'll come to this, that Webpack will handle this, that will create index.js, which it should treat as the app's entry point, and that's how, and we have to pass that to the npm, right? So it kind of works hand in hand. We have dependencies part of it, right? When you're building a library, a generic library. So dev dependencies and neb dependencies, if you've worked with npm packages enough, you might be familiar that dependencies are like the direct dependencies of your app, right? So say you are building a web app, React might be a direct dependencies of for you, right? If you are using, say, for network request, you are using Axios or something, that is a direct dependency for you, right? Because you need that during the runtime. Dev dependencies are something which you don't need it during the runtime, but you need it for the development purpose. Say, Jest, right? Or Babel, Cypress, right? You need that for the development purpose, for the testing purpose. But when you're bundling your app, you exactly don't need it, right? And what the third type of dependencies, we have a peer dependencies, which you won't use it if you are just have a say front end app, but you might need it if you are building for a library, right? Which you know that a client is going to use, right? So what peer dependency exactly is? So peer dependency means that this package that I'm bundling, right? This will just not work if you do not have this particular, in this case, React as a dependency in your host, right? What I mean by that is, say I'm building a UI component, right? And my UI component is built on top of React, right? So it is very much given that if you are using my library, then you should have React also as your dependency, right? So the peer dependency, when I say this npm, sorry, okay, fine, yeah. So when I say peer dependency, what I mean is the client that is going to install this npm will see, hey, you're installing this package, you're installing my awesome library, but my awesome library has React as a peer dependency to it, right? But I see like in your host project, in your client project, you are not you do not have that dependency, right? So it will throw a warning. So npm does not like directly fail. npm install direct does not directly fail, but it shows you a warning that hey, it has the peer dependency that is mentioned, the one which you are installing, but it does not, you do not have it, right? So it will throw a warning, and the runtime you'll definitely see the in the browser that you'll definitely see that hey, something is wrong. So this is what you might want to look at, right? So these are the difference between dependency, dev dependency, and peer dependency. Right. So now look. Now let's look at how Webpack interacts with the npm. Right. We have a npm. We have a package.json that is specifically defined for the for how we are going to distribute our package, how we are going to distribute a library. Now look at. Now let's look at how we are going to bundle our library. Right. For which we are using Webpack. Right. Right. So this is an example. Webpack.config.js file. We all know Webpack can get like really messy and really complicated. This is just a, probably you can say tip of the iceberg for building a Webpack configuration, right? So some of this might be pretty obvious. Like I have given mode as production. This could be a runtime building time variable, either production or development. Depending which how you are building it, right? Say you are building from the CI, so you would want to give mode production. If you're building for a local for testing, you can give mode staging. So it might take up from the process.env or somewhere, right? Now we have the entry here, right? So now the entry you see here is from the source, right? From the source that we have defined, like in say our source code in the SRC, and we have index.js, right? And index.js is your development directory, which have the index.js, and that is like exporting all the business logic of your app, right? In this case, your app is a library, so. Similar to if you compare it against a React project, we have app.jsx or TSX, which has the main component exported, and we have an index.js which imports the app and puts it in the document. React DOM creates a or rather put that particular node inside whatever the container div that you want to put it in, right? So this is similar to that from your development directory, you are exporting an index.js, which it will take it as an entry and bundle. So whatever then comes, whatever imports that comes after this, it will like kind of bundle it around that, right? So here you can have, you can think about lazy loading or code splitting, or there are numerous things that you can do with Webpack. So we are not exactly going to the detail of it, but yeah. So then DevTool source map is basically to generate a source map out of your bundle, right? Otherwise it will be a minified chunk of a huge JavaScript file or how you defined it. So that is that. Output is basically how you are going to output the file that is that the Webpack is going to produce, right? So I say here that, hey, output in a path called dist, right? So path.resolve is basically, it will resolve with a local relative import, relative path to where it is right now, and it will create a dist folder. It will create a file name called index.js into the dist, right? So, and here is where we export this thing from our package.json of npm, saying that hey, the entry point of this entire thing is dist/index.js, right? So these two go hand in hand. Now then we have a library. Basically it the name, kind of, we can say what we give, what we want to give, and this is to kind of, you know, have a alias for the Webpack to understand what is going on, and we can give package. We are basically giving the whatever we have defined in our package.json, right? Now, library target is a pretty important stuff. If you are targeting around building your project or rather building your library for different purpose, right? For different clients. Say you want to build a library for node specific, for server side, or you want to build something for your client side, that is browser, or you want to have maybe something which serves both server as well as front-end client, right? An example could be the calculator file, right? The calculator.js, which basically literally takes just few arguments and passes around the return. It could go set in both. It could go set in server. It could go set in the front end because it's literally just JavaScript, right? React, say you are building a React server, that will obviously go in front end. If you're doing something with, say, manipulating maybe, say, database, querying something, that would probably go sit in the server. But there's something to take in mind. So we'll be talking about the library target in a bit. Right. So this is, until this point in time, we have defined that, hey, Webpack will take in a file, bundle the output, and bundle the output based on the parameters that we have passed in, right? Now we talk about externals, right? So externals in Webpack is the same thing as what we have defined in the, as the peer dependency, right? So we say that, hey, obviously for my app to build, for my library to build, I need React because I'm obviously building it on top of React, but it does not has to be a direct dependency for the bundle to be generated, right? It has to be a dependency for the client, right? So you will tell Webpack that, hey, React is an external library, meaning you will get it from the client, right? But not from me. So Webpack will have a sort of dynamic import at this point in time saying, hey, if you say I'll get external React, I believe you and I'll get it during the runtime, which is when the client installs it and the client bundles it. So the client should have the React, and that's why if the client doesn't have React, it will throw a warning, basically saying, hey, I expected a React something, like window.react.something, but I did not get it. So I don't know what to do, so I'm failing, right? So, and that's where this thing comes into picture. Then you have module rules, which is pretty basic. It says basically to, if you have any JSX file, just use Babel loader for this. You can also extend this to n number of rules, saying if you have a CSS file, if you have a SAS file, you would want to use a particular specific style sheet loader for that. Similarly for icon or anything as such, right? So till this point in time, we have seen that how the package.json and the webpack config kind of goes hand in hand. You will have to kind of see that, hey, so from the source, I have an index.js, which is my entry point for, like, which is like my developer point of entry point for the entire project for the source. But post than this, I'll just delegate all these things to Webpack. And once that is done, NPM will take care out of that generated dist folder, right? Out of that bundle, out of that output of the bundler. Right. So let's talk a bit more about the library target that we just discussed, right? So one second. Right. So we have in JavaScript ecosystem, we have usually three kind of module definitions. We have UMD, we have AMD, and we have CommonJS, right? So CommonJS is usually a server-side pattern, which basically says that, hey, you might have seen in the if you have built any node applications, you would do something like fetch, I think, something for fetch it has. So const fetch equals to require of fetch. I think it's a request or something. Basically what it does is it has a require that, hey, I want this require pattern, right? But the thing here is it is built specifically around having node in mind. So it does not take care of asynchronous dependencies that client side usually faces, right? So asynchronous module definition is what we have to for which is much more suitable for the browser environment, because otherwise, let's say your you have a dependency which you do not have it yet, like it would like in the front end side, you might not exactly have it in that point in time, the definition, and it might be asynchronously fetching that definition. But that but in that point in time, you also would want to show a something in to your in the UI saying that, hey, I am doing something, please hold on, right? So that is for asynchronous module definition. Require JS if you have used Browserify is built out of this thing, right? And then we have universal module definition. This is like combination of both, right? And can be used for both your front end clients as well as server clients. So it kind of has the mix of both things, right? Right. So by now, we have a source. We have a source code which your we have an app which have a source which have all the APIs exposed out of it, right? You have then you have a webpack configuration file which takes in that entry point of your development environment, bundles it, and then you have a npm config, which is package.json, telling you how what to do with the bundle, right? Exactly. Now we move on to like how do you test your library? It's pretty basic. Like if you have been following Kent C. Dodds, a pretty prominent figure in Just System, he tells you about like never to exactly go into the implementation details of any library that you are using it. So from the, let's say, your client side, you shouldn't be exactly testing your library logic. So you have React, right? You have React in your app, but you do not exactly test how the React say use effect works, right? You just say that, hey, I have this and I got this, so this should be your testing strategy. But now, since we are in the library ecosystem right now, the APIs of that or whatever code that you have written should be unit testable with the thought process in mind that given this thing, given something, I'm expecting this out of it, right? So then in that case, you have kind of separated out how your library is tested and how your client is tested. So if you take care of the testing of your library separately and your client separately, you should be good. And like then you kind of have all the logic tested. So giving a very, very simple example, say you have built a design system, UI design component system, and say a select, right? A drop down, say. A drop down can take in the list of items dynamically, right? It might be if you click on this thing, I click on the drop down, it fetches from the network call, and then it populates the data into the select drop down, right? So this thing, it is, if you see it, if you are going to build this component in your front end, you would want to test it thoroughly, right? I click on this thing, click happens, and then the network call happens, and then after the network call is done, assuming it is a success, if a network call is done, and then you are populating the data into the dropdown, right? But now, since you are building the select component separately, and you would be just testing that, hey, I click on this thing, the dropdown opens, and I have the data, this is rendered with the data, right? And in your app, then in your client, right, you would just be testing that, hey, if I pass in the data with an asynchronous code, it shows me a spinner maybe when it is loading, and then after then it is done, right? Probably the spinner logic can also go and sit in the library. But yeah, basically modularizing your testing, and this will also help you in splitting out or segregating out how you would want to write the code, right? Because you have tested your library exhaustively and your app exhaustively, so it should be good and good. Right. So by this, we have a library ready. We have tested it out. We have bundled it. We have a client that is ready to use it, but we have not exactly deployed it. So let's talk about the deployment strategy and the consuming strategy. So since we are using NPM, there are already many popular options if you're deploying it publicly, right? There is NPM registry, which you can deploy it.
Varun, sorry to interrupt you. So before even moving to sure. this deployment strategy, so we have a question from Ankit. So would you sure. like to answer that?
Yeah.
You can ask the question otherwise. So advantage of having package mentioned in peer dependencies instead just in dependencies.
Advantage of having package in my
peer
dependencies instead of just dependencies. Sure. Let me go to package.json. You're talking about this, I believe. So React, if I put it in my dependencies, right? It is going to bundle my awesome library, right, with React as well, right, which is going to basically increase the bundle size of my library, right? But I know that my library is only going to work with, since it's built on top of React, it's only going to be the client that is using it should have React in place, should have React as a dependency installed in them, otherwise it will just not work, right? So having React in my dependencies as well as the client dependencies. Rather than that, I can just tell my bundler as well as my package manager saying that, hey, React is one of the dependencies, but you will get it from the client, right? So when you do an NPM install, NPM install will see, hey, this is you have library X, Y, Z, and you have a library called My Awesome Library React. Now it will see in My Awesome Library. It has a peer dependency called React, right? And NPM will then complain, hey, it's mentioned in my awesome library that it has a React as a peer dependency, meaning it should be installed in your app, in your project as well, but it is not, right? So it will just give you a warning. NPM doesn't fail. It just gives you a warning, but you'll definitely see the failure, the error during the runtime. I hope that answers the question.
Yeah, I think Ankit has mentioned. I think you can continue your deployment strategy and just a time check, Varun. So maybe sure. you can wrap in another 7-8 minutes. That should be good.
Yeah, that's, I think, more than enough.
Oh, cool.
All right. I was at deployment and consuming, right? So I was talking about the if you are planning on deploying it public, right? NPM has made it a lot easier to deploy it. Again, there's a lot of knowledge base around how you can deploy it. I think literally just NPM publish for this thing. Although it checks for your private equals to true. So if you have set private equals to true, and if you're trying to publish it, NPM will fail, saying that, hey, you have mentioned it as private, right? Or something around that. Please don't hold me accountable for that. It's I don't know, something around that. Yeah. And also, since GitHub and NPM like are literally under the same umbrella, you have now GitHub registries, I think NPM registries, on which you can publish it. But again, this only works very well if you have a public repo, right? If you're planning to deploy on public, because both of them works really well if you have a public repo, right? If you have a private repo, you have some sort of cap on it, like you for each NPM seat you have to pay this dollar, or GitHub you can have this much installs per month, or something around that, right? So I'll be talking mostly about private deployments because this is from my personal experience. So we were building a in-house NPM package, it works very well till this point in time that you have this thing built and ready, and you can also test it locally. But how do you deploy it so that other people can use it, right? So that your CI can use it, your other projects can use it. So NPM can actually install a package from GitHub. You can specify a commit or a branch or a tag, right? So say if you can do an NPM install React, but you can also do an NPM install Facebook/React. And this is one of the release that they have found V version 16.13.1. This is a release tag of there, the one which they have released. You can also mention a branch. You can also mention a commit SHA here, right? So NPM will install that for you. I think it also works for the Bitbucket. I'm not exactly sure, but something around that. So NPM can install a package from GitHub branch or tag. So as long as you have a version, as long as you have version controlled, you are good at this point in time. So you can mention your dependencies as React or like MyAwesome library with your user name or your company account / the library package name and the commit or whatever, right? Now, what happens here is it is not exactly deployed as a dist, right? What you are now doing is basically you are literally telling NPM that, hey, fetch this particular branch or a commit or whatever. So this is basically the entire source code at this point in time. This is not exactly the bundle that we want, right? The optimized bundle that we got from the webpack. So we kind of have to build this around our host. Like so we have got the source code, but we now want to build it, right? We don't want the entire SRC and test and all this things. We want the dist out of that, right? So you would have to add a prepare under your scripts, under your scripts object, which will do the which will basically do this thing, right? So when prepare is a hook for NPM, which gets called when you run an NPM install. But this obviously will add up to the build time because, again, you are bundling it within your client, within your host. So this is what actually it looks like, right? You can see all the things are same. I have just added a prepare script here, right? So prepare calls NPM run build, which is this, right? So what exactly is happening here is when I do an NPM install, right, from my project, which has a MyAwesome library as a dependency of it, it will see that, hey, I go to MyAwesome library package.json and I see a prepare script here. So what I'm basically telling NPM is to build this first and then fetch the dependency, then fetch the dist that got built into my client, into my project, right? So that is what it is doing, and that adds up to the build time. That is basically it. If you are going for a deployment which can be hosted on a GitHub, which basically you are fetching from a GitHub registry. GitHub, not exact registry, it's basically a source control version system there. Now, another thing that's kind of a bonus section you can maybe skip if you're not using Docker in your CI, right? So now you want to build it for in your CI, right? So we are using Docker in our CI, and we noticed that, hey, the dist, it is entirely not available when you are building it, right? So you have built it successfully though. NPM will say, hey, the build is successful, NPM install is done, right? But then your app entirely fails. When you try to see it, why it failed, it will see that, hey, the MyAwesome library dot whatever API you're exporting is not entirely there. Hint, this only happens in Docker, right? Very weird. So the reason for that is basically you have to add in config in your Docker file, set and save firm true, which basically the reason for that is the NPM that runs is runs as your root, runs as your user, right? So you have your root and you have your user, which you run in your commands as, right? Which is not exactly super user. So npm expects that to run as a user and not a super user, but Docker usually runs as in your as your root, right? It runs as your default root. So the prepare script, if you like, you can actually like maybe go and see how the source of that is built, the entire thing. So this is a, everything is Node here, and Node is like open source project. You'll see that when you run a prepare, it has a check to see that hey, is the current user super user, and if it is there, it will just silently gracefully fail. It will just run build and it will exit, so it will not generate a dist folder over there, right? And that is why the dist is not there, and you do not have your index.js out of this, and when you try to import that at your runtime, it basically fails. So to fix that, you might have to add npm config set and save for improve. What this does is it allows the prepare hook to also run if you are running as a root. So yeah, that's a bonus section over there, kind of. Yeah, and that was all from my side.
Awesome. Thank you. So thank you, Varun. So guys, if you have any questions, we have 2 minutes for if you have any questions, you can raise your hand, you can type in. So Varun will be there for some more time. If you have any question, you can directly chat with him also. If no questions, I think we are running out of time. We have one more session left. So in a couple of minutes, we'll be starting our second session. That's more of a small talk, so it will be 15 minutes talk by. So stay tuned, guys. We'll be just starting that talk in a couple of minutes. Thank you, Varun. I really loved your session. So I think it must be helpful for others also. So stay tuned, guys. We'll be starting our last session of the day.